About 6 years ago, 7 years ago, I preached a funeral service for a gentleman in our church by the name of Carl Schuler, and I was going through his obituary and found that he was a graduate of Brooks Bible College like 50 years ago. And I had never heard of Brooks Bible College, so it's really great to know that it's still up and running and God's using it for good. And I'm excited today to be here. Thank you for the invitation. Really appreciate it. Oh, looking forward to opening God's Word today. Before we do that, let me tell you a story. Bob Kellerman wrote in his book the title of it is Sexual Abuse, Beauty for Ashes. He opened that book with this story. It was the day after their twin son's 11th birthday that Ashley and her husband Nate came to see me at church. Ashley, with a trembling voice, shaking hands, and tears streaming down her face, shared with me that 25 years earlier, not long after her 11th birthday, that a relative had begun sexually abusing her. Those who knew Ashley would have been shocked. She grew up in a church-going home, actively served at church as an adult, served as a group leader in the women's ministry, and it was always pleasant. As Ashley described herself, "Yes, I'm a good girl from a good home, the good mom, the good wife. But nobody knows the ugliness I feel inside. Nobody knows how I've pretended and denied all these years. And I just can't keep faking it any longer. Inside, I'm a mess, depressed to the point that at times I've thought of suicide, always fearful and anxious, terrified I'll displease someone, terrified someone will find out what an empty but evil thing I am." And as Ashley's voice trailed off, her husband Nate, sitting there with her in the pastor's office, said, "Pastor Bob, can you help? Does the Bible offer any hope for my wife?" Well, brothers and sisters, I don't know you, just coming, but my assumption in coming here to Brooks Bible College today is that you are here because you believe that our God cares for the Ashleys of this world. Right? That those individuals, God loves them, and that the men and women and children who have been violated sexually and physically and emotionally and verbally and mentally need the truth of God's Word. The statistics are staggering today. 1 in 6 boys under the age of 12 in America are victims of sexual abuse. 1 in 4 girls in America under the age of 12 are victims of sexual abuse. That's 60,000 kids in the United States have been violated sexually. Just 10 years ago, Sean Hornbeck and Ben Owenby, you remember the story, they were found. It's hard to believe that was 10 years ago, but they had been abducted and held and been violated. So that riveted us and reminded us that that's taking place around us. 1 in 4 women are victims of intimate partner violence, according to a book on domestic violence by Chris Moles. Staggering. And there's no evidence to suggest that those statistics are any different in the local church compared to outside the local church. 25% of the women that we worship with on a Sunday morning have been victim of intimate partner violence. In other words, somebody they know that they should have trusted or been able to trust or rely on has perpetrated violence against them. So, Nate had 2 questions for his pastor that day. The first one is, "Can you help? Can you help, Pastor?" "Why, no. I just came. I planted this church in a growing suburb because I just wanted to be a church planting pastor, and I wanted to see souls saved, and I really like cool worship music, and I've been to seminars on how to grow attendance and increase offerings. I got no help for you." No, that's not the answer. That's not what God's called us to do. There's no question about the fact that God has the ability to help that person. The question is our church prepared? Is our pastor, are we prepared to help Nate and Ashley. People like that in our community. Do we care enough to offer hope to those who have experienced the horrors of sexual abuse? Do we have any biblical hope to share with men and women in that pain? Will we as a church learn to offer help? Are we wanting to reach out and help people? Well, I was at a conference last year where Chris Moles, the author of that book on domestic violence, was speaking on that topic. He's an ACBC certified counselor, and he was speaking to a bunch of people in the room, but he said specifically to the pastors, and I wrote this down because I heard the sincerity and the point that he was making. He says, "Pastors, be sure your congregation knows that violence against women and children is a sin." It just challenged, you know, me, and I heard that, and I came back and, you know, preached on Sanctity of Life Sunday. About the issue of, you know, we not only value life in the womb, but we value life outside the womb and believe that all humans have dignity and all humans are created in the image of God and none of them should have violence perpetrated against them in any way. So if we think about that on Sanctity of Life Sunday, it's normally focused on the unborn child. If we were to say, does the Christian church care about the unborn child? We'd say, absolutely. We know the Christian church today cares about the unborn child. How do we know that? How do we know we care about the child that's in danger of losing its life to a late-term abortion? How do we know that? And you can answer this. What are examples in our church that we would know that Christians care about that? What do we do? Yeah, we're having babies. We care about children. Amen. We have nurseries, right? We're filling them up. That's good.
Reading scripture, Sanctity of Life services.
We have a Sanctity of Life Sunday service. We take up an offering to help different organizations in our community. Anybody ever held a picket, a sign on a line? Sure. Yeah, done that. Yeah. Okay. Anybody ever hear or find information about an adoption as a loving option and suggest that to people who are, you know. In other words, there are actions that both pastors and church members take because they believe that that life is precious. And we as pastors, I think, have done a decent job in that area in our society of equipping our church to say, hey, let's provide some truth here. Let's be ready to engage our culture and step out and help people based on what the Bible teaches and about life in the womb and the value of life in the womb. So we've taken action in that regard. We've helped prepare our churches in that regard. Praise the Lord for that. That's wonderful. But what are we doing for the person whose private world is being violated? Have we as pastors prepared our church to help people in that regard? Well, as pastor of Grace Baptist Church, I want people who have been sinned against, are being violated by violence, to know that our church stands ready to listen to their story. That they're surrounded by love. That our church stands ready to sit with them in their sorrow and walk with them on the journey of healing and finding purpose. We as a church want to point them to the Redeemer and help them live in light of that eternal hope. So we've just tried to equip our church with compassion and knowledge. And it's a process. It's not a one-time service. It's not a one-message thing. It's just this process of understanding that we live in a sin-cursed world, and sin is a huge issue. But the reality of living in a sin-cursed world is that people all around us are suffering. And we want to prepare people in our congregation to be a church that interacts with the community that's suffering. There's a word in the biblical counseling community called sufferology, right? Mm-hmm. Sufferology. I'm sure Josh has heard it and is using it. And what is sufferology? Well, it's the theology of suffering, right? That's what the name suggests. So it answers questions like this. Where does suffering come from? Who is sovereign over suffering? What are the purposes of suffering? How can we endure suffering? How should we respond to suffering? And as Christians, pastors and people who are doing ministry in local church context, we need to have a robust sufferology. And we need to help the people we minister to have that same ability to handle suffering that's taking place. So a pastor and a church who has a biblical view of suffering will be able to look at Nate and Ashley and answer that first question. Yes. Yes, we can help. The second question he asked, are we able to help victims of abuse? So the question was, literally, does the Bible offer any hope for my wife? So, does the Bible have answers for Nate and Ashley? Well, yes. Yes, the Bible has answers. Everyone say this, the Bible is sufficient.
The Bible is sufficient.
It is, absolutely. Praise the Lord for that. The Bible is sufficient. Now, I grew up in a church in the, you know, in the seat of the buckle of the Bible Belt of America, right? I grew up in Springfield, Missouri. And then there was a church on every corner and a brown derby on the other corner. I grew up in Springfield, Missouri. And I grew up in the type of church that preached and taught and memorized and quoted and sung and at times even waved the Bible. Amen? Amen. I mean, it was a Bible-believing church. I really believe the church I grew up in, there are people who would have died for their Bible. You know, it was God's word. But if you ask them, does the Bible have answers for Ashley and Nate, they would have said, here is the number for the psychologist and they have openings. Okay? They just didn't know how to help people who were victimized or in any number of ways. And I grew up in a pastor's home. I went to the flagship school of our fellowship, 4 years Bible college. I went to 2 years of seminary, and I made it through all of that until I was 26 years of age, before the first time in my life I heard someone say and tell me, guess what? Not only is the Bible inspired and inerrant, but the Bible is sufficient. How does that happen? How do you grow up in a pastor's home and go to church and go to seminary and all that stuff and not hear the Bible is sufficient? But it just wasn't, it wasn't something I was taught. So as a young pastor of an old church dealing with real life issues, I knew I was way over my head. And I was encouraged by a deacon in our church to go get some counseling training. And so I went to a church that offers local church counseling, and I sat that very first day, and I just needed some help. I needed some answers because I had people like Nate and Ashley with various life issues coming to me and saying, Pastor, can you help? And I was like, I've been a youth pastor before, right? As a youth pastor, you have the young people in your youth group, and they break up. They break up, and they come, and they're crying, and so-and-so doesn't like me anymore. And you look at them and say, man, there's more fish in the sea. don't sweat it. It's not a big deal, right? But then 1 year later, the church called me to be their pastor, and now the mom and dad are coming to me, and they've got three kids, and they've got life on the line, and their marriage is falling apart, and they're saying, Pastor, we're breaking up, and you can't save them. And there's more visions. And by the way, it probably wasn't a really good answer as a youth pastor. Okay, but the reality is, the problems I was dealing with as a pastor, God, the consequence of those life issues just ratcheted up. And I wasn't confident that the Bible had answers. Now, it was great for me to preach from, but I wasn't equipped in the office to help them. So I heard it at the age of 26, for the first time, I heard the Bible is sufficient for life and godliness. So with the time that we have left, we're going to look and certainly try to encourage us with that reality that the Bible is sufficient. So what does the sufficient Word of God do for pastors when they deal with the Ashleys and Nates of their community and church? Well, I think there are two answers to that question this morning that we'll have time to look at. Number one, here's what the Word of God does. The Word of God, in all of its sufficiency, gives us as pastors and ministers of His Word clarity in the midst of chaos. Okay? It gives us clarity in the midst of chaos. Because of sin and suffering in this world, when people come into our office, or we're talking to them on the phone, or, you know, the emergency came and we go minister to them wherever the context is, in their home, at the hospital, whatever, and we begin to gather that data and the information of the burden of sin and life and suffering just gets piled on that desk in front of you. You kind of feel like a pastor, and I'm just trying to grapple with this. I mean, this is years of stuff going on in your life, and you're gathering that information, and you're like, where do I begin? What do I do? The chaos of their life, the wreckage is huge. What do I do? Because the pile just grows quickly, and the depth and layers of sin are very real. So, let's just take Nate and Ashley. Is there anything in the Bible that would help us understand the issue of sexual abuse? Is there any text of Scripture that might, and you, again, you can answer, you can talk back to me here. Is there anything that would help us?
So, Tamar?
Yeah, absolutely. The story of Tamar. We're going to look at that this morning. Is there anything else?
David's son. His daughter.
Yeah, okay, that's the one we're going to look at. So we're going to look at that this morning. Okay. Anything else? There's a lot of stories in the Bible, a lot of narratives in the Bible that deal with sexual sin. But I think that one is the best one in dealing with the topic of sexual abuse. So let's open our Bibles to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 13. The context of this is important, certainly. Where do we find the story of Amnon and Tamar and that sin? Well, it just comes two chapters after another sexual sin that occurred in the kingdom of Israel. The sin in 2 Samuel 11 of David and Bathsheba, and then in chapter 12, the confrontation of him by the prophet. Confession of that and the consequence of that, and as part of the consequence of that, there would be successive sin in the generation of David following, and we just immediately begin to see that. And really, I think it's helpful even as you read the narrative, chapter 13, you can't pull that away from the story of David and Bathsheba, because David's even a part of this chapter as well. So this is a great chapter to enlighten us and inform us and help build us and give us clarity on the topic of sexual abuse. And again, Bob Kellerman in his book, Sexual Abuse, Beauty for Ashes, really develops this in full, and I would suggest that and encourage you to study that even more. What's happening in the story? Well, Amnon, who was first in order of succession to be king after David, had a half-sister who was beautiful. And the story says he loved her, his desire was great for her, so all he could think about was her, but it was not possible for him to have her, though within legal ramifications and David being the king, Tamar suggests later that it might have been possible that King David could have arranged it in a right way. But certainly it wasn't in line with Leviticus, the law of God, for him to have her as a half-sister. Jonadab provides counsel, and some even suggest that Jonadab was in cahoots with Absalom, who Absalom basically was playing everybody because he wanted to overthrow the older brother and take the throne, as later chapters would reveal. But Jonadab proposes to Amnon that he take Tamar through a deceitful plot. And so we pick up the story in verse number 10. Then Amnon said to Tamar, "Bring the food into the bedroom that I may eat from your hand." And Tamar took the cakes which she had made and brought them to Amnon, her brother, in the bedroom. Now when she had brought them to him to eat, he took hold of her and said to her, "Come lie with me, my sister." But she answered him, "No, my brother, no. Do not force me, for no such thing should be done in Israel. Do not do this disgraceful thing. And I, where could I take my shame? And as for you, you would be like one of the fools in Israel. Now therefore, please speak to the king, for he will not withhold me from you." However, he would not heed her voice, and being stronger than she, he forced her and lay with her. Then Amnon hated her exceedingly, so that he hated so that the hatred with which he hated her was greater than the love which he had loved her. And Amnon said to her, "Arise, be gone." And she said to him, "No, indeed, this evil of sending me away is worse than the other that you did to me." But he would not listen to her. Then he called his servant to attend him and said, "Here, put this woman away from me," and bolt the door behind her. Now she had a robe of many colors, for the king's virgin's daughters wore such apparel. And his servant put her out and bolted the door behind her. And then Tamar put ashes on her head and tore her robe of many colors that was on her, and laid her hand upon her head and went away crying bitterly. And Absalom, her brother, said to her, "Has Amnon, your brother, been with you? And now hold your peace, my sister. He is your brother. Do not take this thing to heart." So Tamar remained desolate in her brother Absalom's house. But when King David heard of all these things, he was very angry. And Absalom spoke to his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad. For Absalom, his hatred, hated Amnon because he had forced his sister Tamar.
Wow.
How does this passage enlighten our eyes, or help, in a sense, bring clarity to the chaos of sexual abuse? Well, it shows us, it gives us understanding about what the victim, in this case Tamar, experienced at the hand of her brother, and even the people who are supposed to support her and counsel her, care for her even after the event. We see what it does to the abused person. It destroys their faith. It destroys their faith. The way the narrative unfolds, like 20 times in verses 1 through 22, we read of family ties. Son of, sister of, brother of, your father, and the connection. This is all people. The very ones who should be protecting and cherishing Tamar are the ones instead who are violating her. Amnon uses her trust to gain access to her body and her soul. And she opens her heart to her father. Her father directed her, "Yes, go take care of your brother." And he betrayed her. So, sexual abuse, in particular, by relatives or people close, destroys trust. And certainly Satan wants to cause all of us to not trust people who should be trustworthy, or things that should be trustworthy, or a God who is trustworthy. A second way we see that sexual abuse from this passage does damage is not just by destroying trust, but by destroying hope. Amnon grabbed her, and the picture is of him seizing her and clutching her, and it's a violent act of rape against his half-sister. And it overpowers her. And her persistent voice is, "No, don't do this." And she has sound and good argument trying to convince him, but he is not listening to reason. He is just, she says, "Don't force me." And there's three times, "No, no, no," is very clear. She identified the realities of what would happen for her shame and disgrace, what would happen for him. He would play the part of the fool. And then she offered an alternative suggested plan. Go this direction. But he was just concerned about himself. And that cruel act of a powerful person over the weak